When I had to provide the abstracts, I made some subdivision of my the things I want to present in talks, and this does not exactly correspond to what I do right now. I think what I announced had a different title. But anyway, I will speak about adaptive finite elements and adaptive wavelet methods. Today I will speak about adaptive finite elements, and tomorrow I will speak about adaptive wavelet methods. Okay, it's not easy to speak after Daniel, because he did, I think, perfect job with his Blackboard presentation. It was very clear, and but I hope I will not disappoint you too much. So, short introduction. Convergence and optimality of adaptive finite element methods were proven for the model problem of Poisson in 2D linear elements in a few papers in the period 2004-2008. And since then, this result has been generalized in many directions, some trivial directions. You go from 2D to 3D, by the way, not completely trivial. But also in non-trivial directions, like if you do non-conforming finite elements, or you do mixed finite elements, least squares finite elements, or you have discontinuous coefficients in your operator. What else? You have right-hand sides which are not in L2. You have non-linear PDEs, different boundary conditions, different estimators. I will use the standard residual-based estimator. Different marking strategies. Instead of a source problem, you can also think of eigenvalue problems. You can think of singular integral, boundary integral equations, discretized using boundary elements. And there are still papers being produced in this direction. Now, recently there was a nice axiomatic framework given for this whole theory. So in this paper by Carstens and Feischel, Page and Pretorius, there was the theory presented, which relies on a few axioms, assumptions, conditions, I think 4 or 5. And if your framework matches these conditions, then the proof runs, right? Okay, so what I'm going to do is, as I said, restricting myself to an easy case, but I will check all the axioms, so to speak, and also show the proof that these axioms give rise to optimality. Okay, these will be the contents of my talk. I will derive a posterior error estimators, speak about newest vertex bisection, then show that the AFEM is a converging method, a linearly converging method, more precisely that the upper bound for the error is reduced in each iteration by some constant, and then show that the AFEM is optimal, and finally, if time permits, I will prove some crucial result about newest vertex bisection proven by Bienieff-Dahmen and DeFore, which I think is a very nice proof. And if time permits and you are not already completely dead, then I will show you that as well. Please do interrupt me if you have a question. You don't have to wait until the end. Yeah. Okay, first question you have to answer, probably you all know, but why would you do an adaptive method? So let's have a look at that. Let U be a solution of a boundary value problem, and let UH be a quasi-best approximation. If you have an elliptic problem, as I will assume, then you get this by computing the Galerkin system. And so let UH be a quasi-best approximation from some subspace, meaning that the error in your approximation can be bounded by a constant times the best approximation error from your subspace. So WH runs over this subspace. Now let's have a look at a typical situation. Omega is a domain in Rn. Our space, Hilbert space H, in which we measure the error is Hm, or maybe Hm0 if your boundary conditions. And let the subspace be piecewise polynomials of order d, meaning piecewise polynomials of degree d minus 1, right? With respect to some quasi-uniform triangulation tau into shape-regular cells of diameter h. Shape-regular cells means the smallest angle stays in the cells, say triangles or simply chess or quadrilaterals, whatever. Yeah, the quadrilaterals, they have nice angles, but okay. The smallest angle in your triangle stays away from zero uniformly. And then you have this well-known error estimate that the error in the best approximation in HM can be bounded by h to the power d minus m, assuming your solution is in HD. Yeah, so that's your error estimate. And if you rephrase this in terms of number of unknowns, so if capital N is the number of degrees of freedom you have invested, which is proportional to the number of cells in your mesh, and the number of cells in your mesh in n dimensions is h to the power minus n, because in each coordinate, think of quadrilaterals, in each coordinate direction you have 1 over h cells, so in total you have h to the power minus n cells. So in other words, this factor here is proportional to the number of degrees of freedom to the power minus d minus m over n. Yeah, so this is the rate, this d minus m over n, that you can achieve when the solution happens to be sufficiently smooth. Okay, but in many cases u is not that smooth. Suppose u is only in HR for some r between m and d, then this nice rate, d minus m over n, will reduce to r minus m over n. Okay, let's have a look at an example. We do Poisson 2D. Suppose omega has a reentrant corner reentrant corner omega, which is larger than pi. That's why it's reentrant. Then, even if you have a smooth right-hand side, generally u is only in the space h 1 plus pi over omega minus epsilon. So u is not very smooth. So if I take, for example, the L-shaped domain, so you have a corner 3 pi over 2, and you substitute this, then the best rate in H1 will only be 1 over 3 instead of d minus 1 over 2. Here m is 1, right? Because now we measure here the error in H1, so m is 1, and so this d minus m over n, n is 2. So this is the rate you would get if you would have a very smooth solution, but instead you get only a third. Okay, now to cure this, the remedy is to take smaller cells in the vicinity of the corners, in particular of the reentrant corners, and using some knowledge of the singularity functions that are associated to the corners, you can design a careful graded mesh with refinements towards the corners, and then you retrieve the best possible rate, d minus 1 over 2. Yeah, that's what you can do. However, then you have to work hard to find this carefully graded partition, and for some model cases you can do that, but suppose you have an equation with some variable coefficients or jumping coefficients or whatever, or many angles, or now then it gets very complicated. You don't want to do that. And here's an example of a suitably locally refined mesh. Here you see a strong refinement near the reentrant corner. I think this was a mesh that was for piecewise quadratics, and then you need also refinements near the other corners. And so this is a mesh with which you can retrieve the optimal rate. Okay, but what I was saying was the following. You don't want to design this mesh yourself. So what is the idea of the adaptive method? They aim at generating quasi-best partitions automatically without using some a priori knowledge. So how do they work? Given a partition, you compute a quasi-best approximation. This is known as the routine solve, and it will be the Galerkin solve if you have a nice elliptic problem. Then you compute cell-wise error indicators. This is known as the routine estimate. And then you mark those cells for refinement that are associated to the largest indicators. Those cells you refine in some way, you do mark, so this is the marking. And then you construct the smallest refinement in which the marked cells have been refined. This is known as the routine refine. Why this fourth procedure? I mean, why do you not simply just refine the guys you have marked? Often you want to have some properties of your mesh like conformity. So if you only refine the cells that you have marked, then generally your mesh will be non-conforming, so you have to refine also neighboring cells, and that's what you do then in the routine refine. Yeah. So refine is basically refining the marked cells plus some conforming closure, say. But we will come to that later on, will be important. Okay, the AFM was introduced by Babushka and others in co-workers in the 70s, 80s. But the convergence of this method, the simple fact whether the solution that you get by doing this algorithm, whether this converges to the exact solution, was in more than one dimension not shown before the work of Willy Dörfler in 96. Yeah, so it took quite some years before simply convergence was shown. But the fact that the method is converging is of course very important, but it doesn't tell you that the method is superior to just uniform refinements. Yeah, because for uniform refinements, you know that you get convergence, maybe with a reduced rate if you have reentered corners, but it will converge. Okay, now in order to prove something, we have to analyze the algorithm. We first do the a posteriori error estimation. I do the standard residual based a posteriori error estimation, and you can find a lot about this in the book of Verfuurt. I consider, as I said, a polygon. In R2, many things can be generalized to any dimension. I consider Poisson. This can also be generalized easily, but let's stick to the easiest case. So Poisson problem, and then the problem is to find U that satisfies this variational problem. I have an energy norm associated to the bilinear form, which in this case is just the H1 semi-norm. And I have a uniformly shaped regular conforming partition. Yeah, the smallest angles in the triangulation stays away from zero, but now not quasi-uniform anymore. My finite element space will be noted like as S tau, which is the space of continuous piecewise polynomials of degree d minus 1, so the order is d, which vanishes at the boundary. U tau will denote the Kerlerkin solution. E tau, calligraphic E, will denote the set of interior edges. And I define also a partial ordering on the triangulations. I write tau less or equal to tau tilde when tau tilde is a refinement of tau. Yeah? And in that case, the set R tau, right arrow tau tilde, is the set of triangles that were refined when you go from tau to tau tilde. Yeah, so these are the triangles in tau which are not present in tau tilde, yeah, because they were refined. Yeah, so that's the set of refined triangles. Okay. Then I define the following error indicators. So I have a finite element function. Then the error indicator, more precisely the squared error indicator, it indicates the squared error locally, associated to a triangle, is defined as follows. It will be the residual in strong form on the triangle, squared and multiplied with the local mesh size, plus h times the jump of the normal derivative over the boundary of the triangle. And if the triangle is at the boundary of the whole domain, you exclude the boundary of the outer boundary, so to speak. So this is the error indicator. Huh? You recall the functions are continuous piecewise polynomials, but meaning that the derivatives are generally discontinuous. So the normal derivative will have a jump generally over the boundaries of the triangles, and that's what you measure here. Okay, and what is h? H is the nth root of the volume of the triangle, which is something which is proportional to the diameter because the triangles are shaped regular. Yeah. Okay, and if I have a set of triangles, I define the error indicator corresponding to the set, or the squared error indicator, as the sum of the indicators of these triangles. And I also need some substitute for the interpolation operator. So different from what we saw this morning, I will not use the Clément interpolation operator, but I will use the Scott-Seng quasi interpolation. But the difference is not so important. For simplicity, I consider here d is 2, so I consider here linears. So I consider an interpolation operator on the space of continuous piecewise linears, but higher order is not a problem, but let's do this for simplicity. What is the problem with the true interpolation? The true interpolation is the continuous piecewise linear function which coincides with the guy you are interpolating on the nodes. And nu is a node. Now, this is not defined because you cannot take nodal values if you have a function in H1, so you have to do something different. And therefore, we use this quasi-interpolator. And what is it? For each node, you select an edge emanating from the node, and you define the value in the node as an average of the function over the edge, a weighted average, so you multiply it by some weighting function in such a way that if W is a linear function, the value in the node will be exactly the value of that linear function in the node. So it reproduces linear functions. Yeah, that's the idea. So you have a triangulation. And if this is my node, then you choose an edge, maybe a different color. You choose an edge for each node. And the value, so you have I tau W in the node. Node. So this is the node. Will be integral of E nu. This is the orange thing, so let's make it orange. Psi nu ds, where this psi is such that it reproduces linear functions. Okay, then you have the same result as Daniel showed for the Clément interpolation. Let's first have a look at the first term. You have that the L2 error is of the order h, assuming the solution is in H1, which is which I assumed from the start. But it is not a completely local operation. So you get here not the H1 norm on T, but you get the H1 norm on a little patch around T. And why is that? This is quite obvious that you cannot have full locality, because if this is T, then the interpolation operator on T depends on the values in these three nodes. And the value in this node depends on what W is doing on the orange edge. And the orange edge is outside T. Yeah, but the orange edge is always in a patch. So this is the whole patch around T. So the interpolation on the triangle T depends on a little patch around T. Yeah, it's a ring of width one, so to speak, in the terminology of this morning. Okay. Okay, now we are ready to prove that this estimator, this residual-based estimator, provides a local upper bound for the error. So what I'm going to do, I consider two meshes, tau and tau til. There is a til that is hard to see, but here's a til, there's a refinement. And I compare the Galerkin solution on tau tilde with the Galerkin solution on tau. And then the statement is that this difference can be bounded by the error indicators on the refined edges, sorry, the refined cells. Yeah. So this is maybe a bit remarkable. Suppose I have a triangulation, tau, and I refine only two triangles. Then you know that the Galerkin solution will change everywhere, actually. Because the Galerkin solution, if you change somewhere the triangulation, the Galerkin solution will change globally. But nevertheless, the distance between the two Galerkin solutions can be bounded by the error indicators restricted to the cells that were refined. And this already shows that these error indicators are not really the local errors. Yeah. Okay. Now, as a generalization of the first result, we have the second result. Formally, you can see this as a kind of generalization, because if I see the whole Sobolev space as the finite element space corresponding to the infinitely refined mesh, so I take now tau tilde, the infinitely refined mesh, meaning that I have refined all the triangles when I go from tau to tau tilde. If I do this formally, so then a consequence of the first result is the second result. You can also do the same proof again, but you can also apply this kind of argument that if you have the first result and you think of tau tilde being the infinitely refined mesh, then you have the second result. Yeah, so I only show you the first result, the proof of the first result. Okay, so let's go through the proof. This distance between these two Galerkin solutions, because this H1 seminorm was just the energy norm, can be written as this quotient. It seems like everything is a bit not stretched, but it's a bit stretched in the horizontal direction or so. But yeah. Okay, now we have a look at the numerator. So I take an arbitrary function w tau tilde, because later I take the supremum of all these guys. So I consider the numerator for some fixed arbitrary w tau tilde, a function from the finite element space. And since these guys are Kalerkin solutions, I may subtract any finite element function from the coarse mesh, and because they give the same result integrated with w tau. And what I will do later, I will take w tau to be the Scott-Sang interpolation of w tau tilde. Okay, but that's not relevant at the moment. Now I use that the fact that u tau tilde is the Galerkin solution. So the u tau tilde with this w thing is just the right-hand side, yeah? And the other part is still there. Then here I write this integral over omega as the sum of the integrals over all the triangles. And on the right-hand side, on the right term, I use just the definition of the bilinear form, and I also split it into contributions on the different elements. Okay, what is next? Okay, now I do integration by parts here. So I move one derivative, one gradient to the other side. You get here the Laplacian, and of course you get the boundary term then, integration by parts. And now you sum over the triangles, and then each edge of each triangle, each edge in the triangulation appears in this sum two times, because from the left and the right, but they have a different normal derivative, and so you get a jump. Yeah, you get a jump of the the gradient here. Okay, what's next? We do a Cauchy-Schwarz. So here you have L2, here you have L2, L2, L2. And now you sum over all the interior edges. And now you use the interpolation estimate. And when I said that I took the Scott-Sang interpolation operator, then I suggested maybe that it is only one interpolation operator, but in this Scott-Sang you have a freedom how you choose the orange edges. Yeah, and if you choose the orange edges in a good way, then this vanishes outside the refinement region. So outside the refinement region, this is just zero. So if I later have to sum, I only have to sum of the guys in the refinement region, because this is just zero outside the refinement region. And the same idea applies here as well. So you do here now a Cauchy-Schwarz for sums, and then you are done. Then you just then you get, and you use the fact that these patches have finite overlap, and you divide by the H1 norm of W, and then you really have this estimate. So it is only Cauchy-Schwarz, and then you are done. Yeah. So this is the estimate. Okay. So this is the local upper bound provided by the estimator. Of course, we would like also to see a lower bound. We would also like to see that the estimator provides a lower bound for the error, but this turns out not to be the case. It's only true up to an oscillation term. So what is the oscillation? The oscillation measures whether f can be well approximated by a polynomial. This error estimator is not good when the right-hand side oscillates very rapidly. So you measure the difference between f and an approximation, the best approximation from the polynomials of degree d minus 2. And you multiply it again with the mesh size, and that's then the oscillation of f on the triangle. And what you can see, if you have a finite element function, then the oscillation is the same as this oscillation where you add this Laplacian of phi, because the Laplacian phi is a piecewise polynomial of degree d minus 1. So the Laplacian is a piecewise polynomial, is a polynomial of degree d minus 3 on the triangle. So it will be eaten by these polynomials. Yeah. So these oscillations are the same. And now you use the fact that this infimum is less than taking q is 0. So you can bound this by that. And this was one of the terms that make up the error estimator. So the conclusion is that the oscillation can be bounded by the estimator. That's the conclusion. Yeah. Okay, and usually the oscillation is much smaller than the estimator, because usually taking the zero approximation is not the best approximation. Yeah, usually this is much smaller than this part. This is okay. Right, now if you have a set of triangles, then the oscillation corresponding to this set is just the sum of the oscillations on the individual triangles. And then we have the following estimate. The error estimator on the whole triangulation provides a lower bound for the error modulo this oscillation term. But usually this one is neglectable compared to this one. If everything is smooth, this is of higher order. But when I say usually, it means that it is not always the case, because otherwise I should have dropped this whole term, but we have to carry it with us, unfortunately. Okay, as a corollary, we get an important result. The error, squared error, plus the squared oscillation is proportional to the estimator. Yeah, and this will be called the total error, or the squared total error. And what we will see is that the adaptive finite element method is an optimal method for reducing the total error. So not only the error, but the error plus oscillation. Yeah. Okay, why is this true? One of the inequalities is already given here, and the other inequality we also have seen, because we have seen that the error or squared error can be bounded by the squared estimator, and also the oscillation can be bounded by the estimator that is there a little bit higher. Yeah, so this is what we have seen. So we still have to prove this result, that the estimator is a lower bound for the error up to oscillation. And what we will do this on each element. So the local estimator will be an upper bound, lower bound for the local error plus the oscillation on the triangle. So we prove a stronger result and then sum over all the triangles and we are done. Yeah. Okay, so sufficient to show this is the estimator restricted to one triangle, and this is the error on the triangle, and this is the oscillation on the triangle. If we have this, then we are safe. We sum over all the triangles and we are done. Okay, now let's assume that f is a polynomial of degree d minus 2, because then this cancels. Otherwise, we replace it by such a polynomial and you get this oscillation term at the right hand side. But for simplicity, let's just take this, that the oscillation is zero. Okay, if I have a function in h10 on a triangle, and I compute this and I do integration by parts and move one gradient to the other side, you get normally boundary terms, but they vanish because phi is assumed to be zero on the triangle. So this is the same as this. And now you do Cauchy-Schwarz and you have this. Okay, now if I divide by the H1 norm of phi, we have found this. This is very easy. And now if we use the following result that I will comment later on, we use that for any polynomial of degree d minus 2, this supremum can be bounded by h times the L2 norm of p. If we apply this to this polynomial, which is also a polynomial of degree d minus 2, and so if you apply this result with p reading as this, and we combine it with this inequality, then we have proven that this part is bounded by this part. Yeah, and then we are done. So the only thing to do is to prove this. And this is easy because you first move everything to a reference triangle. You do this affine mapping to the reference triangle. Then you get rid of this h. And then you see here you have a norm on the finite dimensional space. And this is also a norm on this finite dimensional space, because for any polynomial you can find a bubble so that this integral is non-zero. Yeah, that's it. And then you're done. So this is the proof that the first term can be bounded by this error, and the second term uses more or less similar arguments, so I skip that. Yeah. If you have understood this, then the second term is basically the same. Okay, so we have now done this important ingredient for our analysis. We have an estimator which is proportional to the total error, and the estimator will drive the whole adaptive algorithm. So this was the first part are there already some comments, questions, remarks? Maybe you have seen this all, or probably not all, I hope not everybody has seen this, otherwise it was useless, but I guess that not everybody has seen this. Okay, now we come to the second part of my talk. It's about Newell's vertex bisection, and this is this can be found in the PhD thesis of Sewell. He introduced this, he or she, I don't know actually. And this is a procedure to create locally refined triangulations that are uniformly shaped, regular, and conforming. Yeah, if you do a standard thing like red refinement, which is known as red refinement, so I have a triangulation and I want to refine this element and I do it by connecting the midpoints of the edges, then you get a hanging node. Yeah, you can say I want to remove it and you have to do this as well, but you have to spread over the whole domain. Okay, you can also say I do a red-green closure, as it is called. I do this, but this gives also problems because if you do an additional refinement here and you do also a red-green closure, then you violate the shape regularity. Yeah, there are maybe methods that to deal with this, but okay. I consider Newell's vertex bisection. So the idea is in each triangle has a unique Newell's vertex and the edge opposite to it is called the refinement edge. And if I want to refine the triangle, there's only one option. You do it by bisection and you connect the Newell's vertex with the midpoint of the refinement edge. So the midpoint of the opposite edge. And by doing so, you create two new triangles. So I have a triangle, suppose this is the Newell's vertex, I indicated an arrow, so this is the refinement edge. And if I want to refine it, there is one option, I do this. By doing so, you create two new triangles, and by the name Newell's vertex, their Newell's vertex is the vertex you just have created. So these are the Newell's vertices of the children. Okay, so, and then you can continue. Okay, in the initial triangulation, of course, you have to make an assignment of the Newell's vertices. There is no history, so what is the Newell's vertex? So you have to choose some Newell's vertices in the initial triangulation. And then is a rule that you should follow. So let's draw a triangulation. The rule is, if this is the refinement, suppose I choose this as a Newell's vertex, then this is the refinement edge, but it should then also be the refinement edge of the guy on the other side. Yeah, so this arrow should be in this way. And if I choose this, then this should be done, I have one triangle left, and I do it, say, in this way, and it has no neighbor, so there is no problem. Yeah, it has no guy on the other side of the refinement edge. There is nothing, so this is allowed. And for any triangulation, you can always find a proper assignment of the Newell's vertices that satisfy this rule. Okay, now all triangles that can be created by this Newell's vertex bisection are naturally organized as an infinite binary tree, right? Because if you do bisection, you have a parent and you have two children, so you get an infinite binary tree, and the roots in this binary tree are the triangles in the initial triangulation, and the generation of the roots is zero, and otherwise the generation of a triangle is the generation of its parent plus one, and all the triangles in the infinite master tree are uniformly shaped regular. This was shown by Mitchell in 1901. It's a nice exercise. Okay, what is now a triangulation? A triangulation is corresponds to the leaves of a finite subtree of the master tree. So you have an infinite master tree, you take a subtree. What is a subtree? It means the roots are in. If a triangle is in, then so is its parent, and also so is its sibling. Yeah, if this guy is in my collection, then also the sibling should be in this collection. And the parent, so the guy which is contains both subtriangles. Okay, that is a triangulation. And generally, such a triangulation is non-conforming. You see it from here. Suppose I did bisection on this guy, but not on this, then you have a hanging node. Yeah, so you create also non-conforming triangulations. But I'm interested only in the conforming ones. So the subset of all conforming triangulations will be the node like as blackboard bold T. Yeah, and I'm interested in that set. And another thing is, if all triangulations in tau, if all triangles in tau have the same generation, then the triangulation is automatically conforming. That's what you see here. If I bisect all the guys, then I get this proof by picture. You see it again conforming, no hanging nodes. Yeah, and so you can. Yeah, so all uniform refinements give conforming triangulations. And that's only because of the proper assignment of the newest vertices in the initial partition. Moreover, if you have a conforming triangulation and you have two neighboring triangles such that the refinement edge of T is an edge of T prime, then either they have the same generation and they have the same refinement edge, or the refinement or the generation of T prime is one less than the generation of T, and T shares its refinement edge with one of both children of T. So let me see whether I can illustrate this here. I have to start over, I think, with this picture. I always want to use this. I don't think I will do it so nicely, but. Okay, I had this picture, I think. Suppose I have refined these guys. Then here you have the situation. This is the refinement edge of this one. It is not the refinement of its T prime. So this is T. This is T prime. It's not the refinement edge of T prime. However, the generation of T prime is one higher, or lower, sorry, lower than T. And once you have refined this guy, and also this guy, so one of the two then you get this arrow here. And so it will be the refinement edge, it will have the refinement edge here. So T will be, T shares its refinement edge with one of the both children of T prime. Yeah? Okay, you can prove this in general, but this is the illustration. All right. Now we consider the following procedure. I have a triangulation, a conforming one. From now on, I consider only conforming ones. And I want to refine T. Yeah? And how can you do it? Now here's the procedure. If the refinement edge of T is an edge of T prime but not its refinement edge, then you first have to make a recursive call with T prime. Yeah? And once you have done it, then you can replace tau by its refinement by bisecting simultaneously the triangles in tau that have the refinement edge of T as an edge. Now it's a long sentence, but let's do an illustration how it works. I want to refine, meaning bisect this triangle. However, if I do so, you get a hanging node. Yeah. So you want to actually simultaneously bisect this, but this will not help because this bisection will be in this direction. Yeah. So the only way of doing this is first making a recursive call for this triangle. Again, if I bisect this triangle, you get hanging node. You would like to bisect to make this bisection, but it's not allowed because this guy has a refinement edge here. So the bisection will take place here. So again, you have to make a recursive call. And again, but now you are in a good situation. This guy shares the refinement edge with its neighbor. So you can simultaneously bisect them. And that's the last sentence. So here the recursion ends. Yeah, so you can do it. And now you get back from this recursion. You can do this, you can do that, and you can do this. Yeah. So in order, now let's see if I can, yeah. In order to bisect this one, I first had to go to some number of refinement, number of recursive calls before I could really do the bisection I wanted to do. And this may spread out over the whole domain. So maybe you want to bisect only one triangle, but you have to do first a million other bisections. Yeah, this may happen. Okay, now, and if you have a set of triangles that you want to bisect, then you have the following routine. You pick a triangle from this set, you do the refinement, and then you pick the next one from the, so this is a set of marked triangles that you want to bisect. You pick some triangle from this set, you extract it from this set, you do the refinement, and then you extract the next one until this set is empty, and then you're happy. Okay, now this routine terminates and produces the smallest refinement in the right set in which all triangles that you have marked for bisection have been bisected. But in generally, you bisect more triangles, as we have seen. Yeah? Okay, another result that we will need, which has little to do with this refinement routine. If you have two triangulations, and from now on, triangulations are those that you create with newest vertex bisection and that are conforming. They are always in blackboard bold T. Then the smallest common refinement that I will denote with the direct sum symbol is also in blackboard bold T, and which is called the overlay. How do you get it? You make the triangulation on a piece of paper. You make the other triangulation on another piece of paper, you put the papers on top of each other and you held it in front of the sun and you see the smallest common refinement. That's the overlay. Okay, and what are the number of triangles in this overlay can be bounded by the number of triangles in tau plus the numbers of triangles in tau tau prime minus the number of triangles in initial triangulation because they are basically in both of the triangulations. Okay, this is not so difficult to prove. Right, now here comes an important result proven by Binev, Damen and Devoor in 2004. And if time permits, I will show you the proof, which is a bit a challenge for me to explain it clearly, but it is an intriguing proof, I would say. But I will do it at the very end, and so you don't notice the mistakes anymore at that stage. Okay, so let's assume I have a sequence of triangulations created in the following way. I start with initial triangulation. I mark a number of triangles for refinement, for bisection. I call the routine refine, so it determines the smallest refinement in which those are bisected. Then I mark, so that's tau 1. Then I mark in tau 1 again a number of triangles. I do the same thing, you get tau 2. And then the result says that at the end of the day, if you do these k steps, the number of triangles that you have, minus the number of triangles in initial triangulation, can be bounded by the total number of marked cells. Which is a bit of a surprise, because if you have a triangulation and you mark only one, it may happen that you have to bisect a million. In other words, you cannot bound this difference. If you go from tau I to tau I plus 1, the difference in cardinality of those cannot be bounded on the number of marked cells because you may mark only one cell and then this is adds a million cells. Right? So you cannot do it in each step. You cannot expect from step to step that such a result is true. But if you consider the whole history from the initial triangulation, then the number of triangles in this the triangulation that you have can be bounded by the number of marked cells, the total number of marked cells in the whole history. This is important because we want to say something about optimal rates and so on. So we want to say something about the cardinality in the triangulation that we have created as we will see, we can say something about the number of marked cells. So to relate those two, we need this result heavily. Yeah? Okay, some... I have time until 4 o'clock or so? Yes, right? Okay. Now, some alternatives for Neuer's vertex bisection. I'm not married to Neuer's vertex bisection, so you can do other things. We can do, say, RET refinements. Okay. You can also work with quadrilaterals, something like this. And all results on a posteriori error estimation remain valid with some additional complications because you have non-conforming meshes, as long as the number of hanging nodes per edge remain uniformly bounded, say by one. So this is not allowed because you have two hanging nodes on an edge. But this is okay, right? You have only one hanging node on each edge. And if you have quadrilaterals, you cannot avoid hanging nodes unless you have uniform refinements. Yeah? So you have to do something. Okay, so this condition, this admissibility condition, substitutes, say, conformity. So everything generalizes to meshes like this with this admissibility condition. Let me denote the resulting class of partitions again with blackboard bold T. Then all results about refine, including the result of BNF-Dahmer-Devor, directly generalized to those partitions. But you have the same problems as we. So let's consider a refinement procedure for this situation. Here is the algorithm that's better to illustrate in this picture. Suppose I want to refine this guy by subdividing it into four. You are not allowed to do it because then you would create two hanging nodes on those edges. So you first have to go to the neighbor and bisect this. No, not bisect, sorry. Subdivide it into four first. But you're not to do it because that would be create two hanging nodes on this edge. So you have to make a recursive call. Now you can do it. Now you can do that. But you're still not ready because you also have to do the same here. And now you are allowed to do it. So that's the algorithm that's given here. So you can also have the situation that you mark only one cell for refinement, that you have to go over the whole mesh doing many refinements. But the same result of being in BNF-Dahmer-Devor applies to this situation. Yeah? Okay, now we are ready to specify the adaptive finite element method. Let theta be some parameter. What you do, you have a mesh and you solve the problem, the Galerkin problem. Now you compute the error indicators for all the elements. And if the sum of all the error indicators over all elements, so the error estimator for the whole error, is less than your tolerance, then you're happy, you go home, yeah, so you stop. Otherwise, you select a set of triangles such that the error estimator corresponding to this set captures a certain fraction of the whole estimator. This is the bulk chasing. Say you take 10%, you collect those guys that represent 10% of the whole error. And you are, of course, not stupid. You are not collecting the triangles that carry the smallest estimators, but you start with the largest because you want to have this set as small as possible. And okay? That's mark, and then you do refine. Yeah, so the smallest refinement, which is admissible, in which those are refined. And this marking strategy is known as bulk chasing or Dirichlet marking. Okay, now we come to the nasty parts. I don't know whether it's nasty, but the proof parts. So the first result is that the adaptive finite element method is R-linear convergent, meaning that the error, or an upper bound for the error, decreases by some constant factor each step. Now the statement is actually a little bit different, because what we do here, we take a weighted sum of the squared error and the squared estimator, and gamma is a suitable constant, and this sum decreases each step by some constant. Yeah, that's what we're going to prove. And we need two lemmas in order to prove this. First, the stability of the estimator. So we have the estimator on a triangle. If I change the argument, I replace phi by w, then it can be bounded by their difference in h1 on a little patch around t. So this is an easy consequence of the triangle inequality a few times and an inverse inequality. I won't give the proof. And the other lemma looks a bit more frightening. So what is here? There is a lambda, a constant, such that for any delta, and with another lambda, this is not so convenient, but okay, another lambda, this is a constant less than one, the following is true. The estimator on after k plus one steps, so here you have the Galerkin solution and here you have the triangulation after k plus one steps, can be bounded by this factor, which can be made less than one, right? Because this is less than one and delta can be chosen to be arbitrarily small, times the estimator after k steps. So that's good news. The estimator reduces. Yeah. There is, of course, bad news as well, because you have an additional term, and this is the difference, with a maybe huge constant, the difference between both Galerkin solutions. So if I ignore this part, then I'm happy. The estimator reduces each step, but I also have this term that will be taken care of later. So how to prove this? The proof is first, we do it for a triangle, first to replace uk plus 1 by uk. Yeah, and now we use the stability. I replace one argument by the other and have to pay for that by a term which measures the difference. So here it is, the difference. And now I sum this result over all triangles and I do the Young's inequality and then you get the following. Just by summing and doing the Young's inequality on this square. And what you see is that the estimator after k plus one steps can be bounded by 1 plus delta times the estimator after k steps. Sorry, I'm wrong. The triangulation is still the same, that's important, but I replaced the new Galerkin solution by the old Galerkin solution. Yeah, that's the point. And I have to pay for doing that by this additional term. Okay. Now, the whole trick is that if I do not change the Galerkin solution, but I change the mesh, I refine the mesh, then the estimator reduces. So let's go back in order to see that by the definition of the estimator. So I have to go many clicks. Oop. Oopsie. Oh, where is it? This is not a very convenient thing. Okay, here's the estimator. Suppose I replace t, I divide it by 2. Yeah, I bisect t, but I do not change phi. Then what happens is that this guy decreases. I think it's multiplied by a half or something. This is the whole idea. So what is there? I only consider here the first term. What is this actually? This is ht squared integral over t, right? If I replace t by two children, t1 to t2, then and I do not change the argument, then this remains the same. If I now sum over the two, ti, yeah? This in total remains the same, but this reduces. Yeah, because this is the square root of the volume. So this reduces by a factor half, I think. Yeah. So the sum of these estimators on the both children together, because of this factor reduces, is smaller than the original one. Yeah, the estimator reduces under refinement. The same happens with the second term. Okay. So that's the key, the estimator reduces under refinement if you do not change the argument. So if you do not change the finite element function. So now I have to go many steps, not too far. Where are we? Here. So what I've done here so far, I first replaced the Galerkin solution by the old Galerkin solution. I had to pay for that. But now, is this the right position? No, it's not. It was here. I replaced the new Kallurkin solution by the old Kallurkin solution. And now I realize that I have the old Kallurkin solution with respect to a refined mesh. Yeah. So this is, on all the triangles that were refined, this is strictly smaller than eta uk tau k. Okay, that's here. And so what I do, I consider those that were marked and those that were not marked and those that were marked and those that were marked have been splitted. So then you really get a reduction. I go a bit quick about the details, but that's the idea. All those triangles that were splitted, you get a reduction. But then by definition of the lambda from here, you get here. And now you realize that this represents a non-neglectable part of this one, because this is the marking strategy. And then you pick up this 1 minus lambda theta squared. Okay, so, and then you get the whole, this is the whole proof. Proof is done. Yeah, the estimator reduces, but you have to pay here. Okay, now we are going to prove theorem 8. We are making progress here. We want to prove this. Yeah, so we have said something about this in relation to that. And now we use the Kallurkin orthogonality. We know that the error between the error after k plus 1 steps is the error after k steps plus, or minus I should say, minus the difference between the Kallurkin solutions. And if I recall the previous result, then you see how it works. If this is small, the estimator reduces. Yeah, because if this is zero, then you see you have a reduction of the estimator. If this is big, then you see that the error itself reduces. So if you take a suitable combination of these two, and that's the idea, then the sum will reduce. That's it. And that is done what is here. You have to take, now I don't go to these details, but that's it. Yeah, I have summarized what is here in details. Okay, so the sum, the weighted sum of the error and the estimator is reduced each step. Okay, now I have to show that the AFEM converges with the best possible rate. For that goal, I first have to define an approximation class to know what the best possible rate is. U is said to belong to the approximation class AS when the right-hand side, this is F, is an L2. I always assume that. And when, for any natural number, there is a triangulation with n triangles, plus the number of triangles in the initial one, such that the total error is of the order n to the power minus s. Because the product of the error, or the best error, times n to the power s is bounded. Yeah? So the error, if you consider the sequence of best triangulations, the error decays like n to the power minus s. Okay, now assuming U is an AS, so the best triangulations give you an error decay n to the power s, we have to show that the AFEM is doing the same thing, and then we can conclude that it is optimal because it realizes the best possible rate. Generally, we don't know the value of s. We don't know in advance what s is, but we don't need that. The statement will be of the type, if U is an AS, whatever s might be, then also AFEM realizes a rate s. That will be the statement. Okay, another way of putting this, use an approximation class AS, meaning that if you want to have an error less than epsilon, you can realize this with a triangulation that has this number of triangles. That's the same way of putting this. We will use this later on. Okay, another thing is, we know that if the solution is smooth, then we can realize a rate d minus 1 over n. But we also have seen, maybe I did not show you that, but this class is much larger, because also if you have all kinds of singularities caused by corners, then the solution will still be in this class. Yeah? So this approximation class a d minus 1 over n is much bigger than the Sobolev space h d. Okay, now we already know that the finite element solution, the adaptive finite element solution, converges to U linearly. So what remains is to properly control the cardinality of the triangulations. And that means we only have to control the cardinalities of the marked sets, because this result, BNF, Damen and Devoor, gives you then control of the cardinality of the triangulations. Okay, now I recall a few things. We know that the error between two Galerkin solutions with respect to nested meshes can be bounded by the estimator, but are now made specific a constant. There is a constant that is doing this. And we also have seen that the estimator on the whole triangulation is a lower bound for the error, modular oscillation, and instead of writing this inequality with the tilde symbol, I now made specific that there is some constant that is doing that. Okay, and now the statement is that you should not be too greedy with marking strategy. You should not mark 90% of the error, but you should mark a theta fraction of the error where theta is sufficiently small, depending on these constants C1 and C2. And then for any triangulation tau, which is a refinement of tau k, and for which the total error can be bounded by this constant times the total error in UK, it holds that the set of triangles that you have to refine for going from tau k to tau realizes the bulk criterion. Yeah, so tau is a completely theoretical thing. You don't have this in your hand, but if you pick a tau that is has an error, total error, less than this constant times the error in your current triangulation, then you know that if you consider the triangles in tau k that have to be refined when going to tau, this set realizes the bulk criterion. And now since you know that you have selected the smallest amount of triangles that realizes the bulk criterion, you can estimate the cardinality of this by the cardinality of this set. And in the next theorem, we show an upper bound for this, and then combining this, we are done. Yeah? Okay, so what is the proof? The proof of this is quite simple. We use Galerkin orthogonality. We use this for the oscillation. I will not go into this, but it is completely trivial from the definition of the oscillation. And this looks horrible, but there is hardly anything. I use the definition of C1. I get this. Now I use the Galerkin orthogonality. This is the first line, and I use also the second line. This is really nothing. What is here? Probably also nothing, but what is happening here? Oh, here I use the Galerkin orthogonality. Now I'm a bit confused. Yeah, maybe you can save me. It follows directly from the conditions, and the C2 pops also up to estimate this difference. But I must confess that I'm. Is this the? I have to use this as well. It follows from this. Yes, thank you. Yeah, second line follows from this, and then the third line follows from these two. And the last line follows from this. Okay, thank you. Okay, and now, so we have a bound for the cardinality of the marked set. It is can be bounded by the cardinality of the set of triangles that were refined from tau k to tau. And now I have to find a bound for that, and that's given here. Okay, by definition of the approximation class, there exists a tau tilde such that the total error is less than this right-hand side, where the cardinality of the tau tilde is, if you call this epsilon, you know that you can create a tau tilde which is of the order epsilon to the power minus 1 over s. And that's given here. It's a horrible expression. If I call this epsilon, then here there is epsilon to the power minus 1 over s. This is by definition of the approximation class. And now I want this tau tilde to be a refinement of tau k, so I simply take the overlay of these two. Then the total error only decreases. And now we use the previous lemma that says that this mk can be bounded by this cardinality of this set. Since if I refine a triangle, then the number of triangles in the triangulation increases by 1, and that gives you this result. This was the result about the overlay. And then finally, this is what I wrote here. Okay? And then you're done. So now I have a bound for the cardinality of the marked cells. And then we are done. Okay, this is the final thing. Before I come to the nasty proof of this Binev-Dam-Defoe result, but it's a new topic, so you can start fresh on that. I don't know if fresh, but you can make a new start. Okay, what is the idea? The total number of triangles in tau k minus the number of triangles in tau zero can be bounded by the number of marked cells. I have found a bound on the number of marked cells. I substitute this. And the bound on the number of marked cells is in terms of the errors, the total errors, to the power minus 1 over s, negative power. We know that the total errors decrease in each step by some constant factor, meaning that 1 over the total errors increase by some constant factor. So you have here a geometrical sum. This increases each step. So I only have to... Oh, I first... this is an equivalent quantity. Yeah, so I was one step too soon. Here you see, you have here a geometrical sum, so you only have to take care about the last term, and then you are done. Okay, what you see here, that the cardinality is optimal, because this is the same bound satisfied by the best triangulation. Yeah, so this was the whole proof. I can imagine that... you cannot recapitulate all the steps, but I hope that I gave you an impression. Okay. Are there questions about this?
So the AS class is a class of functions that can be approximated in optimal order by ship-regular triangles.
Yeah, by the family of triangulations that you can create by newest vertex bisection.
Yeah.
But you can relate it, if I ignore the oscillation term for the moment, you can relate it to best of smoothness of the solution.
Can you replace that definition by a definition that allows anisotropic refinement?
Yeah, that's a good question, because if you go to three dimensions, then you, in order to get generally optimal rates allowed by the polynomial order, you need anisotropic refinements near edges. This has not been done, but this is important important question and important open thing issue, I think. Yeah. Because I always assume shape regularity, and as soon as you do anisotropic refinements, you lose that. So you have to be very careful in all the steps. Yeah, but it would be very interesting to do that. Yeah. Okay, so my last topic is the proof of this Binev-Dahmen and Defoe result. Yesterday evening I thought it would be a good idea to do this as well, in view of the fact that I have 1.5 hours, and I'm probably not allowed to stop too early. You are keen to learn more. So I took this from some old slides, so the notation is a little bit different. So it is more general, actually. So what I call the triangulation is now a partition. So this calligraphic T is now replaced by P, P of partition. And I consider a more slightly more general situation. I consider, instead of bisection, I consider a rule which replaces a triangle or whatever cell by K children. So K, for bisection, K is 2. And if you have quadrilaterals, K is 4. And what I called the generation is now the level. Yeah, so if you do bisection and you have a triangle on level L, its diameter, its measure, sorry, will be 2 to the power minus L. And the first equality up to constant means that the things are shape regular. So the volume is proportional to the diameter to the power n, if you are in n dimension. So shape regular cells, and on level L, they are their volume is k to the power minus L. Yeah, that is the situation, and bisection fits into this if you take k is 2. Okay, moreover, the assumption is, or the condition is, that any, let me call it triangle, that any triangle T prime created by a call refined PT, so I made a call in order to refine T, but as a byproduct, I may also refine other triangles. Yeah. So if any, for any T prime newly created by this call satisfies the following two conditions, its level should not exceed the level of T plus 1, and its distance from T prime to T should be bounded by this quantity, but this quantity is proportional to the diameter of T prime. That's something you derive from this. And both conditions are satisfied by Newell's vertex bisection, but also by the other bisection procedures I showed you for quadrilaterals and so on. So to consider the first one, if I, let me see. Suppose I call the routine refined with this triangle, then if you get an immediate bisection, then of course the levels of the guys you create are only one higher than the level of the guy with which you called the routine. Sometimes you first have to do recursive calls if before you can really do this bisection. But these recursive calls always involve triangles on lower levels. Yeah, so using an induction argument, you see that you can never create triangles by this call which have levels which exceed the level of the guy with which you did the call plus one. Yeah, is that clear? Yeah. Another thing is, you may spread out over the domain. You may do bisections on elements far away from the element with which you made the call. But the condition is that dt prime t can be bounded by the diameter of t prime. This is an equivalent way of writing this condition. And why is that? If you make recursive calls, it is always on coarser levels. So if you have a, let's make a picture. Suppose I want to subdivide this square. If I make a recursive call, then it will be on a neighbor, but on a higher level, sorry, lower level. If I'm not satisfied, I cannot do it, I first have to refine a neighbor, then this will be on an even bigger scale. Yeah. So if this is the rectangle or the square with which I made the call, and this will be subdivided as a consequence of this call, then the distance between these two will always be proportional to the diameter of T prime. Because you can move away, but then the elements become bigger and bigger. Okay, so you can go over the whole domain, but then you go to coarser and coarser levels. So in this way, you can prove that this distance, so if T prime is created newly by the call, then the distance can be bounded by the diameter of T prime, some constant involved. Okay? So if you have these two conditions, then at any time in the AFM algorithm, the cardinality of the partition, minus those that are already present in the initial partition, in the following I will ignore this when speaking because I break my tongue on this sentence. So the cardinality of P can be bounded by the total number of marked elements. Yeah, that was the idea. Okay. So now there comes a very ingenious idea, I would say, by Binev Dan and Devoer. So let PB denote the final partition, M denote the total set of marked elements in between, and P bar denotes any intermediate partition. Okay. Okay. So M is a set of triangles or elements for which a call refine has been made for any intermediate partition. Now we are going to construct a mapping on the product of the set P and the set M that satisfies this inequality and this inequality. Okay, you can read what is there. Suppose that these two inequalities are valid. Then from the second inequality, you find this. This is just this inequality summed over this set. You see, I think. Now you interchange the order of summation, and you use the first inequality for this sum, and you end up with this. So this works, right? But nobody understands what is there, I guess. But it works. So what is the interpretation that was given already by DeVoer in one of his talks? I think it was also in the paper. We are going to construct a mapping that takes two arguments. The first argument is an element from the final partition, and the second argument is always denoted by T prime, and the second argument is a marked cell. And this lambda T prime T can be interpreted as the amount of money spent by T on T prime. Okay, so the marked cells spend money to the cells in the final partition. So say the lecturers spend money to the participants. And what is the first condition saying? Now you sum over all the participants. Sum over all the participants. It's saying that the amount of money spent by each lecturer is bounded. Yeah, because you are summing over all the receivers and it is bounded. And the second condition is saying that each participant gets a non-neglectable amount of money. That's the second. And that means that you can bound the number of participants by some constant on the number of lecturers. If you have five breads and two fishes, you cannot feed the crowd unless the crowd is not too big or there are some miracles around. Yeah? So that's the basic statement. So that's the idea about this lambda function. Yeah? So lambda T prime T. T is always the marked cell. The second argument is the marked cell. And T prime is the receiver, so the cell in the final partition. Okay, this is a bit busy slide, in particular because I don't have pauses made in between to get some overview. Okay, we first define some sequences. So this is a summable sequence. It starts with minus one, a bit odd, but it's a summable sequence. This is also summable, but since there is a k, k is larger than one, k is two or four, whatever, this b sequence may increase. Yeah? So you can always organize that b times a is the infimum is bounded from below. Okay, so a should be decreasing, but b can be increasing in such a way that you have this, and in such a way that both sequences are bounded. You can do it. Okay, now I define a as the sum of this sequence multiplied by some constant that will be defined later. Okay, now we're going to define this lambda function. So lambda is the amount of money spent by T to T prime. T prime is a cell in the final mesh, and T is a marked cell. Now the idea is only to spend money on a cell which might be created as a consequence of the call refine PT, where this is the marked cell. And we know that if T prime is created by this call, this T prime cannot be too far away from T. The distance between T prime and T should then be of the order, the diameter of T prime, sorry. T prime can only be created by a call refined T if the T prime is not too far away. And that's the first condition. The second condition is we know that the level of T prime can never exceed the level of T plus one. Yeah, so we spend only money to those cells in the final partition that might be created as a consequence of this call. And moreover, the amount of money spent depends also on the level distance. If the level of T prime is much lower than that of T, then the money will be very small. If these levels are comparable, then you are close to zero, or it starts at minus one, this A sequence. Then the amount is non-neglectable, but if the level difference becomes large, the amount of money becomes smaller and smaller. Yeah, you have to think about this. Okay, now we first have to check that the amount of money spent by T is uniformly bounded. That was the first condition. Okay, we only have to, let me see, we sum over the receivers. We sum over the triangles that might receive money. And we collect all the guys that might receive money element-wise. We organize them element-wise. So on each level, suppose this is the T, this little box, and this is a certain level, and then the only squares that may receive money, they are in a neighborhood which is proportional to the diameter to the red cell. Yeah. Fixing a level, you know that there are only finitely many squares which are in such a neighborhood. Yeah, so for each level, there can only be finitely many receivers. Okay, and so if I have to sum over all the receivers, I do it level-wise, as I said, but on each level, the levels cannot exceed the level of T plus 1, so you start with level 0 and you sum up, and you sum for each level there are finitely many uniformly, so that's in this constant, and I only have to sum over what they receive. And that decreases because this was a summable sequence and this is bounded. So this argument shows that the amount of money spent by T is uniformly bounded. Yeah, and now I have to show that the amount of money that each element in the final partition receives is non-neglectable, and then I'm done. Okay, so when do you receive possibly money? When you are not too far away and your level does not exceed the level of T plus 1. Okay, so let's have we pick a triangle in the final partition, which is not already in the initial one. Yeah, and we number in a strange way because this final guy will have index 0. Okay, this final guy is generated by a call of refine with argument another triangle T1. This guy was created by a call of refine and this one, and it starts always at the triangle in the initial mesh. Yeah, so this is the final triangle. This is a triangulation. Sorry, this is a triangle in the final mesh, and this is the sequence of intermediate guys that were in these. That were the arguments in these calls. Yeah, and you start always at the initial triangulation. Yeah, everything starts there. And these blue, sorry, these black dots indicate their levels. So you, if you make a call and you create as a consequence the next triangle, yeah, so by definition, let me see, yeah, the numbers, if you start with TL, and TL minus 1 is created by this call, its level cannot exceed the level of TL plus 1. So here are the levels. So you cannot go up with more than one level, but you can also go down. Okay? So this is just an illustration. And now what we have to show is that all these black dots, these are all triangles for which calls were made, you have to show that the total amount of money spent by all these guys is non-neglectable. Yeah? And what is the proof? In the proof, we show that with Q, the smallest index, such the level of TQ is the level of T0 minus 1. So from here on, you never go down to this, you never get lower than this red dotted line. We will show that the total amount of money spent by those guys is non-neglectable. So we forget about the first part. Okay. In order to check that these guys spend money on the blue dot, we have two criteria. We have to show that the blue dot is not too far away, and we have to show that the level of those and we have a level criterion, but all those black ones satisfy the level criterion, so we only have to check the distance. Okay, let's do that. So let's verify the distance. The distance between T0, that's the final one, and Tj. So I consider the distance between, say, this one and that one. Yeah, so this is T0, this is T1, T2, and so on. You number in the wrong direction, which makes it a bit confusing. This is triangle inequality. The distance between T0 and Tj is the distance between, you can bound by the triangle inequality, by the distance T0 and T1 plus the diameter of T1 plus the distance T1 Tj, and you do the same trick again. So you get all these distances, and you get the diameters. Tk minus 1 was created by a call refined with argument Tk, so you can bound this distance on the diameter of Tk minus 1. That's here. The diameters, we also have an estimate, and you can combine these two, and you have this. And yeah, I think I will show you the rest by picture. I do this picture. What is the idea of the proof? I think the details will be a little bit too much. The idea of the proof is either, let me see. Now maybe I go back. I think you get tired, but I get tired as well. So you organize these TKs, the intermediate ones, level by level. Again. So you write the level of TK as the level of T0 plus P. So here you have the P. And now you count the number of TKs that have level P. And that's this number. And that, what is going? And that's this number. Now, if all these numbers are not too big, then this is the constant A, and you conclude that Tj is not too far from T0, so it spends some money. And if this holds for J is Q, if this one is not too far, it spends a non-neglectable amount of money, because it's the amount of money spent is A with argument minus 1. The level difference is only 1. Yeah. If this is not true, then there is a J, so that there is a J star, so that J star is already too far. Okay? So this J star is already, Q is too far. If Q is not too far away, then you're done. If Q is too far, it means that there is some index, if you count from this side, so that J star is too far. It doesn't spend money. But this can only happen when there is an intermediate level where there are many triangles that spend money. And because of this amount, they all spend a small amount of money, but because there are many of them, the total sum of what these purple guys spend is enough to be non-neglectable. Now, that's the idea of the proof. It is very technical, a bit too technical this time of the day. But I hope I gave you an impression. What I like about this proof, it is completely non-standard. I have never seen something like this. It's not that you say, I have some well-known technique, I adapted a bit and you get this. It's completely original, as far as I know. Maybe somewhere in the literature you find something like this. So I think it's very important result. And yeah, it gave the important result that the number of cells that you have at the end of the day can be bounded by the number of marked cells, and that was crucial for giving the proof of optimality of AFEM. Okay, thank you for your attention / patience. Yeah. So tomorrow I will speak about wavelets. I guess it, maybe you're not acquainted with wavelets, but I guess it is a bit easier. No. I don't want to scare you. With is hurting after some time. This I think.
Yeah. And you might have to do that. You feel that you need it.
That
you couldn't hear it.
No, they record.
Oh, I see.
It's not on. It's not on.
That's what they're
doing. Probably because he paid too much for the lights here. He was the only one who didn't edit.
You always talked about triangles. So this, but this Mitchell thing becomes complicated for tetrahedra. So the same things are working.
I will tell you about this. It becomes more technical. Also this.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Even, you have to first collect all the guys that share some entry points and do a bisection. It becomes more complicated. Actually, I have some slides where you
is there a set of notes for this lecture? It's not part of your contract.
No, guys, the slides.